nothing to me but customers.
You want to freeze to death?
Oh, it's really
Alan.
What's up, everyone? Welcome to another podcast here with the Movies Revealed crew. And we're coming at you with another movie review. And it's almost sad. We're like halfway. Remember when we started this and, you know, we felt like we had the whole summer in front of us, but now we're in July and
summer is flying by.
It is. Yeah, we only got a few movies left before we get to the fall. But thank you again for subscribing and listening. And if you're here again listening to us for another movie review, be sure to hit that like button and subscribe for more movie content. Like I said, another movie review on the slate this past week. We got a new installment of the Indiana Jones movie saga. Bum, ba-dum, bum, ba-dum. And we got Indiana Jones and the Dial of Destiny. Destiny, destiny, destiny.
Yeah.
Came out last week, PG-13, clocking in at 2 hours and 34 minutes.
Yeesh.
We're going to talk about that a little bit. But here we go. Here's a synopsis straight from IMDb. Experience the return of legendary hero Indiana Jones in the fifth installment of this beloved swashbuckling series of films. Finding himself in a new era approaching retirement, Indy wrestles with fitting into a world that seems to have outgrown him. And to my virtual left and to my virtual right, I have the boys back at it again. Say hello.
Yo, yo, yo,
yo, yo, yo, it's me, BB boy. No, be nice, as in be nice to me when I talk about this movie.
Please be gentle. And here we go. It's me, Teddy Kumar. I'm in this movie. You guys probably don't even know who he is. He's the Mexican.
Is that the boy?
Kid. Yeah, the Mexican kid. I had to look up his name. Yes.
Well, we're back at it again here for another movie review. And if you haven't listened to the previous movie reviews, they are available wherever you can listen to podcasts, as well as on our YouTube channel. And if you're watching us right now on YouTube, what's up? Like and subscribe. But I feel like the summer was going pretty well so far. I think we can all agree on
you
that.
Think
like,
so?
Movies yeah. were going pretty well. And I feel like it was amping up. And then this movie happened. This is a spoiler-filled review. Just a reminder, we're talking spoilers here. If you haven't seen it, go see it, come back. But if you don't care, just jump right on in. But like I said, this is the fifth installment of the Indiana Jones saga. We had Raiders of the Lost Ark, came out in 1981. Temple of Doom came out in 1984. Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade in 1989. And then we had a long period of no Indiana Jones films. And in 2008, we got the notorious Indiana Jones and the Kingdom of the Crystal Skull. And then a few more decades passed by and they thought they would tap the series again. And we got Dial of Destiny. Now, that's what you need to know. But also the other thing that you need to know is this movie is directed by James Mangold. Why is that so important? Well, the rest of the films were directed by only one director, and it's the famous Steven Spielberg. So this is the first time that we are seeing an Indiana Jones movie that's not directed by Steven Spielberg. And just really quickly, I want you guys to answer this question. Did you notice?
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Now I don't want to jump too much into this topic, but I'm really interested to know. So you did notice that it wasn't directed by Steven Spielberg. Do you feel like that was a good thing or a bad thing?
Way bad. It was so bad. And I could go into this. Yeah, go ahead, Edward.
I was going to say it's the directing for me wasn't necessarily the problem. There were issues I had with the directing. It was mostly the writing, which did Spielberg write the previous films as well, or was he just the director?
It was a combination of different writers, like Lawrence Kasdan. George Lucas always came up with the story, and then it would always, you know, be handed to like some screenwriter. So each of them had different ones.
Okay, because you could tell this movie has four credited writers. You could absolutely tell that there were too many cooks in that kitchen. But as far as like the feel of an Indiana Jones movie, I personally, for me, it hit the notes, like the high notes of what you expect in an Indiana Jones movie, but it just didn't land as well. I guess I could notice,
because
but not probably
the director
to an extent.
Was different.
Yeah, probably not to the same extent that you guys did. So.
And I thought about this because I totally agree. The director, just having a different director for this one, you could tell something was off, and I couldn't quite pin it when I saw the movie until I saw Kingdom of the Crystal Skull. So I saw Dial of Destiny first, and I actually never had seen Kingdom of the Crystal Skull before in its entirety. What? Yeah, I know. And so I saw Dial of Destiny first, and then just for fun of it, I was like, well, let me see like Kingdom of the Crystal Skull because everyone talks crap about it. And so I decided to watch it. And right off the bat, you could tell like, oh, this is Indiana Jones. This feels like how it should feel compared to the other one. And I think that's what makes Indiana Jones the way it feels. Like Steven Spielberg is so closely tied to Indiana Jones that to take him out of it takes away some of the character of Indiana Jones.
Yeah.
It's interesting. And I kind of hate bagging on this because I feel like it's always important, especially in a saga, to have new blood, to always have a new vision. And I think sometimes that can work, but you're right. And I never thought about it as much as that, but like, it is interesting to know that, or to think that Indiana Jones is so closely related to Steven Spielberg.
Yeah.
Because you're right. Crystal Skull obviously is not up to the tier as the other ones. Even though I really enjoy it, I don't think it's the worst one. I think Temple of Doom is the worst one, but maybe this one actually. You know, it's a Steven Spielberg film, and there's like this lightheartedness. There's like this Western feel to it. It's like, the way it looks, the way the characters are moving, them playing with the silhouettes, you know, the camera
it's so
being
classic cinema.
The one things I always notice too is like the camera is always stationary, and it's like either moving with the characters or like the actors are moving within the frame. And it's always just fun watching that. But this one was like quick cut. It was like Edward mentioned it. Yeah. Edward mentioned it in our text conversation where Indiana Jones is this like timely classic, but then was kind of put into this like 4K modern style of action filmmaking, which just really to me was like literally almost jarring. Like my eyes weren't like set to it. It was just so weird. It just like it didn't mix well for me. And I was genuinely surprised every time they played the Indiana Jones theme song, because it reminded me again of, oh yeah, we're watching an Indiana Jones movie. Oh yeah. And so it was jarring to me.
Yeah. And you know, with like modern filmmaking, what they do is they like take a bunch of shots, you know, and so that when they're in the editing room, they're able to take what was the best shot, you know. Yeah. And so that's what it feels like, is that like it doesn't feel intentional like Steven Spielberg did. It felt like his shots are really planned out and they're really thought out. And with this one, like you said, like it's a modern take, and it just doesn't have that same vibe.
Yeah.
That same feel.
Which is, let me ask this question here. So James Mangold is not a newbie. He's done some great films, and Emily and I find ourselves being like unintentionally James Mangold fans, just because he's done a lot of movies that we really love. A few of them are Logan, The Wolverine, Walk the Line, Ford versus Ferrari, Night and Day, 310 to Yuma. So he's not like a newbie. He's done this before, which I think we have to maybe talk about the elephant in the room, that I feel almost like there was a lot of, because it's such a special property, right? And we've been here before. I feel like there was some commingling on Disney's part here to standardize an Indiana Jones movie. Because we've seen Mangold. Like, I've seen his movies, and I know what he can do. Like, you just have to watch Logan. Like, this Indiana Jones movie easily could have been that. And it starts off that way, weirdly enough. But it just, like, went into, like, a stereotypical Disney action flick that we've seen with these really special properties like they've done with Star Wars. That's how I felt like the rest of the movie went.
I don't think it was much of a corporate meddling. My honest thought with this film is that this should have been done by Spielberg, because this is the last one. And I understand getting Mangold because of Logan being able to have a send-off for the character. But I mean, the thing about Mangold, he's done two Wolverine movies, so he already kind of understands the character. Not to say he didn't understand Indiana Jones, but this was basically Spielberg's and George Lucas's baby. I really feel that Spielberg should have been the one to do this, because that emotional impact is not there. But what Mangold was able to do with Logan, he could not do with this movie, because the movie doesn't even end definitively. It literally ends with like, are you back? Are you back? And the whole movie, it's like half the time it's setting up Wombat to be the new Indiana Jane. That's half the movie. And
please,
so
no.
On one hand, we're supposed to be saying bye to this beloved character, you know, just it's kind of a reflection of us as the audience. You know, maybe Indy has outgrown this generation of filmmaking. I don't think it's impossible to make a film like the old Indiana Jones in the modern era, but this wasn't it. This was Uncharted with Harrison Ford, to me, is in its feel. But I just feel like for it to have that emotional, impactful ending, that definitive ending, that definitive send off where Indy rides off into the sunset, it should have been Spielberg. I don't think Mangold was the guy to do it.
Yeah, I think what's important to note too is like James Mangold is taking an iconic character like Indiana Jones and trying to replicate that. And we've seen James Mangold handle characters like Logan, but James Mangold doesn't necessarily carry on that same Logan that has been previously established. It's like a different Logan, you know?
Yeah.
And so I think that's kind of what the issue is that James Mangold had trouble translating this iconic character, or like keeping it the same, keeping it feeling the same, you know?
Yeah. I'm just really so surprised. And I guess that's where some of, I don't want to say hatred, but where my distaste for the movie comes from, is I feel like on paper, the marriage between a character like Indiana Jones, where he's not a superhero, he's a man, and he just is a really cool hero, you know?
Yeah.
And to see him paired up with a writer and a director like James Mangold, where we literally seen him do that exact same thing, not just with Logan, but with a character like Johnny Cash and Walk the Line, like he can do it. So to me, I've seen him do it before. And I know what's different about this one is that Disney had a huge influence on it, you know, because George is attached to it and Kathleen Kennedy is attached to it. It just, you know, that's
so you're putting the fault on Disney.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. They failed again at updating another. And you pointed out exactly two of the things that always gets me mad about these Disney flicks that are coming out. You know, for a fact, watching this movie, they were trying to spin it off for Wombat. They were trying to give her the hat and the whip so that they can make their little Disney Plus TV show and spin off 10 more episodes for their platform. That's number one. They do that all the time. And then number two, they cannot kill anybody off. That was Mangold. He does that. He when he's writing an old character, it makes sense that they would ride off in the sunset, metaphorically or literally physically dying. But this one, you cannot kill Indiana Jones. Why? Because he's Disney's property. He's an action figure.
Leave him in time, though.
There's no repercussions. And even, it's the same thing over again. We're watching, again, spoilers, but they time travel, which is ridiculously stupid and just dumb. We'll get into that. Just, oh my God. Anyways, and I'm not on edge because I know he's not going to be stuck there. I know they're not going to let him die there. Why? Not because it's Mangold, not because it's Harrison, nothing like that. Because I know Disney was in charge because they don't have the balls to kill off their characters because they care too much about their freaking toys and making sure that their Disney platform has enough material if they need to go back to that because they lack originality and creativity. This movie is another piece of disappointment. It had so much potential to become such a, you know, rewrite the wrongs of Kingdom of the Crystal Skull and really do justice to Harrison Ford and his dedication to the character of Indiana Jones. And they didn't. They missed the mark. I'm so glad Disney's having financial troubles. I hope they have more financial troubles. I'm glad people are being held accountable.
But would him dying they deserve really it. Would that really change any like well, would that really be the proper send off for him? Because I disagree with that.
Well, here's the thing, and that's why I said metaphorically, like you could write him have him ride off into the sunset. Like,
yeah.
I'm not saying, you know, he needs to be stabbed in the chest by a stake but like Logan. And you look at The Last Crusade. I mean, The Last Crusade is pretty perfect where they're riding off to the sunset.
Yeah.
That's the most Indiana Jones thing. It's just like, you know, he's going to ride off into the sunset on a horse, hoping for more adventures to come. But this stupid, wacky, Looney Tune BS at the end of the movie with that hat is hanging up and then his hand reaches back in. What? Come on, man.
Yeah.
I'm going off on this movie.
They should have put a lot wrong. Indiana Jones will return.
I don't care. Indiana this Jane movie
will return.
Wombat will return.
I'm cutting to the end. I'm giving my rating. I think this movie is. The more I talk about it, the more I hate it. I did not like it, even watching it in the theater. So this movie is a piece of crap. That's my rating. And you know what? Like, Emily and I, we're not too hard to please because when we go to a theater, we know like it's time away from the kids and it's like time together. Like, we watched Jurassic World last year and we enjoyed it. We enjoyed it because we know it was like just this fun, whatever. But this one, man, yourself. Like, this movie tried really hard to have us not like it. Like, we both walked away and we were like, yeah, that's not it.
Wait, so what was your actual score? Like, what did you give it on Letterboxd?
That's a good question. Let me pull it up.
Letterboxd.
And if you're not following us on Letterboxd, be sure to follow me at Chris Goat Nolan. And then I don't know what your guys' Letterboxd is.
Because I totally agree with you. I was so disappointed in this movie, and I was looking forward to it. I really was. Based off the trailers, I was so excited to see it, and it looked like it was going to be promising. Mm-hmm. And then we saw the reviews kind of come in a little early because I guess it was like shown at a film festival or something.
Yeah.
And at that point, what was it, like a 60%, I think?
Yeah, it was hovering around 60, yeah.
And then the reviews started coming out like the day before, and I was hoping it was going to get better, but it just didn't improve. And it there's so many things flawed with this movie, and there's so many things I didn't like. I can't even tell you good things that I liked about this movie because there was nothing. There was not the movie was too long, characters were boring, the plot was basic. They would just like go from point A to point B, and then talk about like history a little bit, and then go like to the next location, talk about history a little bit, and then figure out where they need to go, and then go to point C, and then it just kept rinse, repeat.
Can I play it? Are you ready to give your rating? Can I play it?
I actually haven't decided my rating. Oh, no, okay. I'm going to give it a 1 out of 5.
Yeah, I gave it 2.5. I gave it a 2.5 out of 5, which I think is being generous.
That's what I gave it to. And the only reason why I gave it a 2.5 was just because
I'm trying to time it with your guys' scores. I'm not just pressing it randomly.
Spamming the poop button. Now, I enjoyed parts of it. Like, there were a few moments where I was bored with what was going on screen, but otherwise, like, the moments where, like, you're supposed to be entertained, something's happening, I was pretty, like, you know, entertained.
Like what?
That's a great question, because I forgot half of these action sequences. You know what? Honestly, I did like the flashback stuff on the train. I did like that. I enjoyed that.
Ooh, no.
The CGI really didn't bother me. Because it was at night, it really didn't bother me. It wasn't flash levels of like unbearable uncanniness. Like, I thought it was
bad.
It was a step above Tron Legacy and Jeff Bridges, I think. It was
okay. Let's talk about that. I know we got a little bit emotional with just going off and hammering at this movie, but believe me, there is structure to this podcast. So yes, let's talk about that opening scene. It's going to be talked about a lot, and Edward already touched on it. It is a flashback scene to the Indiana Jones we all know. And obviously Harrison is not that age anymore. So they use a lot of CGI, a lot of de-aging, because Lucasfilm just had millions of images of his face from back then. So they're able to do that. I thought it was interesting.
I thought it was fun. I thought it did its purpose, but no. The rest of the movie wasn't like that because he's 80 years old. He can't do half of that stuff. Even a lot of the stuff in that sequence was absolutely ridiculous, like how he fought against the dude with the machine gun on the bike in the caddy. Like, that was he's got superpowers in this movie, guys. He's got plot armor, literal plot armor, just complete and total luck. But this...
That opening sequence was just way too long. I was looking at my watch. I'm like, man, we're still 30 minutes into this opening sequence. It's like 45
minutes long.
Like... Yeah. And I'm like, this ain't no Indiana Jones. Like, the opening sequence, I feel, for like an Indiana Jones film should be like 15 minutes. Like, something quick, something fast-paced, something, you know, charming.
Right.
But this one was like 30 minutes. And like, at no point I was like, I wasn't on for the ride.
Yeah. So I'll say this about the de-aging. I think it was very noticeable. It was a very risky decision, in my opinion, because even if it looked great, the thing with that is it's always noticeable. Mm-hmm. And you are, like I said, whether it's good or bad, like, you are going to notice it, and it becomes the main thing that you see, like, to the point where you're not even really focusing on what's actually happening in terms of plot. Like, you just are just fascinated with like how much his face looks like plastic. And Emily said it looked like Polar Express. And I was like, I don't know if it looks that bad. I don't know if it looks like that clay. I will say this though. There were moments I was pretty surprised. I was like, whoa, that's actually pretty good. But that was like 5-10% of it. The rest of it was like,
you must have been rubbing your eyes or something.
if it's going to be noticeable, and if it takes away from the movie, it shouldn't have even be considered. And I thought it was the wrong choice to do that. And I've heard them explain thematically why they needed to do that and why they wanted to do that. Cause we haven't seen Indiana Jones like this in decades. And so we wanted to give the viewers and the fans a shot of the old Harrison Ford. And it was just, no, like, it's
boring.
Just
boring.
Yeah. And I think that's when I had the inclination too that we were probably in for a rough movie, because the action, it was like I had no idea what was going on. It was like close, quick cuts, and it was in the dark. And you point out a perfect scene where they're like fighting over the gun. I have no idea what was happening. I just saw like the flares.
Yeah.
And I could see his plastic face in the midst of it. And it was just cutty. And it was just, it was so disappointing. And you know, I think it's not that hard really to mess up an Indiana Jones movie, in my opinion. I think you just have to really tap into your inner child and just start shooting. But it's overthought, all of this. Like, they thought way too much about it, mm-hmm. and they overcompensated and they just did too much. It's really sad how dumb this movie is.
I was also disappointed by how they killed off Mutt.
Off-screen. I was giggling when I saw his little photo right next to the flag. I'm like, he did it off screen.
No, I saw Kingdom of the Crystal Skull afterwards and I was like, oh, this is actually pretty cool. Like, I don't know why people were talking crap about Shia LaBeouf, but I was like, I could see him as a potential replacement for Indiana Jones. And then they just completely kill him off in this one.
Yeah. I mean, it's neither here or there. It was kind of sad once you thought about it. It was kind of sad once you think about it. You're like, man, like, he was really fun. Like, if anything, he's just fun in Kingdom of the Crystal Skull. He's not annoying. Yeah. He's not any of that. He's just fun, you know? But I guess they needed a plot device to, like, sink Indiana down more than he was. So they decided to kill his son. But let's jump into the next thing here. And this is kind of... this is a hot topic, I think, and you guys have already talked about it, but Phoebe Waller-Bridge comes into the picture here in the Indiana Jones saga, and she plays Helena, also known as Wombat. I want to know what you guys think about, because it's pretty obvious, right, what they were trying to do. They were trying to pass that baton to her. She got a lot of screen time. She gets a lot of screen time. So... go at it. What are your thoughts?
Go ahead, Edward. Go off. Lay into him.
Let me preface this by saying I have nothing against the character archetype of the guy or the girl that thinks they're invincible, they can do anything, and that they're smart about it. Like, that they're just on top of the world, or the best of what they think, they're the best of what they do. But oh my God, she was the most annoying version of that archetype. Yeah. And I think the biggest issue is that they treat her like a legacy character. She's not. Like, correct me if I'm wrong. Was Wombat in any of these movies?
No, I cannot recall. She wasn't.
Yeah, so like, it would have made more sense if it was like Short Round. Like, what happened to Short Round? Did the kid die? Like what happened to him? Because this girl just comes on the scene and she acts like she's the best. You know, she's really great. She's super smart. Indy has this connection with her. We have no idea who she is, or her dad, who just keeps playing German-speaking people that might seem like bad guys in every movie he's in. I don't understand. But God, she was so annoying. The scene that lost me, the scene that completely lost me, not just the her taking the dial of the destiny and then running out the door, but it was when they're in Morocco, they go through this whole thing, whatever, they're fighting over the dial. It's like it's a action set piece. And then they're like, the police outside are cornering them, and then the police run away and these cars show up. I'm like, oh, is this going to be like a legacy villain? And then she's like, oh, no, that's my fiance. He's like a really like big deal in these parts, because I'm just so I'm supposed to marry him, but I left because I'm an independent spirit. And like, that was when she completely lost me. That entire scene was framed to be like, this dude's a big deal. I don't even know his name. And he's just in one chase scene and that's it. He's supposed to be, I guess, the... like that big dude that Indy's supposed to fight or whatever. Or no, that's the Russian guy that was in there for like 5 seconds.
Yeah. Yeah.
But that was the moment where I'm like, I'm not going to like this girl. And then she talks about, she's like, oh, I got by because of my beauty and my intelligence. Like, shut up. Like, Who are you? Who are you? What? I don't care about this person. They try so hard to make you care and like her, make her this like super plucky, like really like just BA kind of like explorer and someone that tries to take advantage and get her own way. Nah, she's the worst parts of that personality. And
yeah,
I really hope they don't do the Indiana Jane, man. That'd be awful. Give me Short Round.
Yeah,
Disney Plus series with Short Round.
You're totally right. It was just way over the top, and there was no reason for me to like her. And like, she did nothing in the movie that made me question myself and be like, "Oh yeah, she is really good at what she does."
she hit the dynamite in her pocket. Whoa, she's so cool, man. Like, man, she's so sneaky and devious. Like, she's talking this dude the plan.
And the kid too. I didn't like the kid. They were trying to sell this kid, the little
Moroccan Mexican kid. Can't swim and then kills a man underwater. His first time swimming, like
he's a murderer.
Well, I just thought it was so weird because he goes through this weird like transformation. At first, he was like, "Why are we following this old man? Like, I thought we were gonna do our own thing, and this guy's dumb." And then, like, by the second half of the film, he's like, "We gotta save Indy. We gotta save him." He's like,
"I don't even think he's talking to him." I don't think Harrison Ford acknowledged the presence of this child. Like, he probably called him Short Round by accident once, and it's a blooper. There's a blooper reel somewhere where he keeps calling him Short Round. This little ethnic kid just following him around, and Harrison is up there in age. Probably just get on my way Short Round. God, like, so dumb.
I'll be on the other side of that. I was actually a little bit surprised when we had texted about the movie after we all saw it. She did not bother me that much. I think there were little things that I could agree with you where they were trying too hard to make her, I guess, seem smarter than she actually was. But I don't know if I was bothered as you guys. I thought she was fine. I won't go so far as what you guys said. There are flaws, yes, in the way that her character was written. But I thought she was interesting. I enjoyed watching her.
Interesting about her?
Well, you named one of the scenes too where I was kind of on the same page where I'm kind of like, okay, you got to prove to us that she's worth being on the screen. Like, if she's going to take up most of the movie, at some point you got to show us like, okay, she's got it. Like, she can at least do something. And it was that scene where she was like, I don't know, playing trivia with everyone in the boat. And she like had it behind her back. And I thought, I was like, okay, you got it. Like, that qualifies. But I think that definitely really isn't the main part of the problem for me with the movie. I think there's way too many action set pieces.
Way too many.
Indiana Jones is too long. Absolutely. Indiana Jones is well known for the movies having back-to-back set pieces. We see that Raiders of the Lost Ark when he's battling on the plane, that they get into the cars and then you have the chase sequence. But this one was like, hey, let's do everything that the past four movies together and let's do it all in one movie. It was just way too much. Like, I literally was exhausted like halfway through this scene where they're in Morocco and they're on the little buggies or whatever, the little golf carts. I was just so exhausted. Like, and it wasn't even like, you know, like Indiana Jones action, I think, is really specific. Like, if you show someone it, it's very natural. It's not choreographed. And Emily brought up a really good point. She said a lot of the action pieces were way too choreographed. Yeah. Like, it was like Fast and Furious choreographed. Like, and it's just like, one, that's not what Indiana Jones does. He's a guy, for God's sake. Like, let's get that right. He's a guy. He's not a god. He's not a god. He's not a superhero. He's not an Avenger. He's a literal professor of archaeology. There's nothing that he does that is supernatural in any sense to the human body. Let's get that correct. Anyone who's writing future Indiana Jones movies, he is a man. He's a male from the human species. And so it's unbelievable when, first off, he's, you know, choreographed and he's like timing things perfectly, jumping, punching. But then also, it's so obvious when I know it's not Harrison Ford jumping from one cart to the other. I know that's a double. I know that's CGI. I can literally see his face put on the body double's actor's face. Like, I can, it's just so unbelievable. Like, I can tell frame by frame. And I don't think it's just because I'm a, you know, we're filmmakers or whatever, or, you know, it's none of that. It's just, it was so jarring and so noticeable. Like, the filmmaking, when you watch an Indiana Jones movie, you, or at least the first three, you walk away and you're appreciative. You're like, yeah, that was really good filmmaking. That was awesome. This one was cheap. It was plastic. It was vague. It was heartless. Had no joy behind it. It seemed like they went straight to the computer and said, hey, we can do it there instead of doing it in live action, which Indiana Jones is absolutely known for. That's the fun of it. I mean, for God's sake, in Raiders of the Lost Ark, when their faces are melting with the Ark of the Covenant, it's silly, but it's, there's this cool aspect to it, knowing that they used prosthetics when they were melting their faces. But yeah. This is just all CGI. I can't, it, you know, the whole underwater sequence was the stupidest thing in the world. It was such eels. A waste of time.
He's just
stupid. Yeah, the eels.
Just fighting the eels like this.
It was such a waste of time. Really, they could have taken that part out of the movie that made no sense for us to go underwater with Indiana Jones, other than they just wanted to cross it off their list.
That scene was badly shot too, because it was dark. And then it was just like, you saw like bubbles and you saw like a flashlight and there was like just eels like everywhere.
And you literally got Indy just literally spazzing out.
Like, it just wasn't thought out. Like, why would, that doesn't look good at all.
No.
And
I'll say this again in this review. I don't believe it's really hard to mess up an Indiana Jones movie. You're not dealing with a superhero. You're dealing with a man who loves archaeology. And, you know, as long as you stick with Germany and the Nazis as the villain and you don't go Temple of Doom route with Indians and them offensively eating monkey brains, which is, no one talks about
KGB.
That anymore.
Yeah.
You know, like, it, there's a specific formula out there for Indiana Jones. And for some reason, Disney could not help themselves and they wanted to do something different. And oh my God, we have not even talked about the stupidest aspect of it. But the fact, why in God's name is Indiana Jones a time traveler now? Why in the world is he jumping back in time? That is, oh my God. I can't take this. Someone take over. I need a break.
Yeah. I texted this to you guys too. I said, like, you have a series where the villains are occult Nazis, demon cult, Hindu demon cults. You have God and Jesus Christ in these movies as an actual entity, as an actual force, aliens, and somehow they made time travel the most, like, out there concept. And since we're on the Dial of Destiny, I don't know how to pronounce the actual name, but
I don't even know what it's called.
Antikytheron or something like that. Antikythera, that's what it's called. I was very lost by kind of the how it was used in the story. So at the beginning, they're looking for the spear that the spear of Longinus that our Longinus, whatever, that pierced Jesus on the crucifixion. Mm-hmm. But that's a fake. Okay, why even bother with that? So then they find, like, now this Nazi wants to find the Dial of Destiny to rewrite time, to usurp Hitler, assassinate Hitler.
I guess he already had it, right? He had, like, half of it, and he was looking for the other half.
Yeah.
And, no, he didn't have half of it. He had it and then he lost it to Indiana Jones. And then he wants to find that half and then the other half. But what does the CIA have to do with this? Do you guys remember that he had a CIA handler that was well aware of the device? And, like, do you remember that woman? Do you remember that woman?
Oh, yeah. Like, right. Totally forgot about her.
Like, there was, like, a plot that got lost somewhere, like, what does the CIA want with it? Because they're aware and they were entertaining it long enough, but then it got out of hand. What, they want to bring back JFK or something? Like, what was the point of having this whole little subplot where the CIA is handling him? Like, I understand Operation Paperclip. We hired Nazis to put guys on the moon. I understand. That's what you were trying to say. Why does she know about the dial? And then that's completely dropped. You got this MAGA dude that just joins with him. No one explains. Like, the Russian guy, I kind of get. This dude from, like, Alabama just like, yeah, I got the honor band now. Yeah, I'm shooting at Romans. Like, that's the problem with this movie. Everything to do with the MacGuffin makes no sense. Everything to do with the emotional send-off makes no sense. Half of these, like, emotional, like, they're not even camp. These are people that have never been in these movies. Like, Antonio Banderas is in this and it's like, oh, it's a good friend of mine. And then he dies. And then the Wombat's, like, laughing it up, cheesing it up with her little, like, servant or whatever. And then he's like, my friend just died. Like, who you talked to him for like five? He talked to the kid and her more than you, bro. And I'm going on a tangent.
Wait,
right now. I'm
he
sorry,
wasn't
like,
in the other movies, right?
No, he wasn't. No, he was not. I have it right here. Newcomers are. Let me see. Okay, the newcomers are obviously Wombat, Antonio Banderas, the guy that plays Wombat's dad, and yeah, the MAGA guy, like those are all, and obviously Mads Mikkelsen, who's like propped up to be some kind of like, oh, I'm like a rival to Dr. Jones, even though he got slapped in the face going like 70 miles an hour against like a metal pole. No,
I was
scar,
surprised
no
I liked
nothing.
Him though. I liked
I was
him.
Surprised he didn't have a scar. I thought he was gonna have a scar the next time
he
saw
was completely
him.
Fine. It's like he got hit in the head with a cartoon mallet and that was fine. Like, he's just like, and it's not like that's what made him insane. That's what made him go into this plant. No, he was already like this. He wanted to do this. And
if there was any good thing, I liked him. I liked him as
he was
just
fine.
Like,
I mean,
playing
Mads
him.
Does that job pretty well. But
he was pretty cool. Remember when the waiter was going out? He's like, "You didn't win the war. Hitler lost."
Oh yeah.
I was like, "That's a pretty cool line."
He was cool.
Sound, I'm like, "You won the war, but now look at you. You're serving me a Nazi food. You're like."
They did pretty good with him.
He was fine for what he did. I just didn't like the concept of the character, but I will get to flex my history degree because the hilarious thing, the thing that I found most hilarious about this whole thing. So the thing about the dial is that Archimedes Nuts is like, he built it to bring someone back in time to help him in his time of need. I literally started laughing because, and yeah, this is a history thing. That war that they went to, the Archimedes lost. The Romans still won. So not only are we talking time travel, we're talking a complete break from the historical timeline where, yes, of course, you got dragons or whatever that the Romans are like scared of and they go away. No, but they actually won the war. So then you're telling me now, as someone that is aware of the history around that, Indiana Jones has not only gone back in time. Not only was Archimedes buried with a Rolly on his wrist, he changed history, which means Mads was right. His character wanted to change history. Like, no, it's a fixed point. It's obviously not a fixed point because that's not how it happened. Make it make sense, Mangold. Like, you have a dead body, a 3,000-year-old dead body with a goddess to God Rolex. He was dripped out. And this is what you're leaving us with. This is your emotional send-off to Indy. And I don't even mess with Indy like that. Like, I'm not as attached to these movies as you guys are. My household.
I'm not
my parents. My parents are a mummy. Like, we're a mummy household, which obviously is a direct, like, homage to Indiana Jones. But, like, this is – I'm offended. I'm offended.
On our behalf.
Yeah,
I was about to say.
On your guys' behalf, yeah.
I do want to reiterate. So, I'm not an Indiana Jones fanboy. I should reiterate that. Like, I don't think we were technically raised on these movies. Like, our dad didn't show all three of us, didn't show all three of them to us. And we sat down one Sunday and watched them all. Like, I knew they existed. Well, I guess he watched it with you then. Not me. I appreciate it. I think Raiders of the Lost Ark is one of the most important movies in film history. And I think this is, again, why I like our group here. I'm the film historian. I went to school for film history. Edward's our historian. He went to school for history. And Brandon is he's a film fanboy. Or
just a guy.
He's not a god. But, he's a guy.
but I'm not coming at this as a fanboy. Like, oh, you ruined my Indiana Jones. None of that. It's just like, and I've seen all of them. I'm just really more baffled than anything that you can mess up a really simple thing that is Indiana Jones. And if there were a list of things not to do, if there were commandments on what not to do for an Indiana Jones movie, I feel this movie does most of them. they do the things that you shouldn't, and really makes the movie unbelievable in a lot of ways. And I really wanted to like this movie. Like again, it's not hard for Emily and I not to like a movie. Like, we understand we're there for fun, but there are certain lines that you cross where the movie does become bad. And one of them being 2 hours and 30 minutes long, being the longest Indiana Jones movie ever. When Indiana Jones movies are pretty, Emily said something really important about Indiana Jones, and I really liked it. But if you watch all the movies, she says what she really liked about the Indiana Jones movies is that it's really simple, start to finish. The movie starts with you knowing what he's after, and then once he gets it, the movie ends. That's it. Like, it's pretty simple, those first three movies, but for some reason they make, like, I don't know, like a twist after a twist. I mean, for God's sake, it feels like J.J. Abrams wrote this movie, which is just not the highest compliment. I mean, I'd rather at this point have Colin Trevorrow come back and do this. I'll say it. I would have had him. I would have had him.
Fair enough.
Oh.
Fair enough.
But can we talk about the other side of the coin? And can we talk about how right now audiences, if you look at the Rotten Score right now, audiences are loving this movie. I mean, when I went to watch this movie, people were clapping when the movie ended.
No way.
And the guy next to me was jiggling because he was laughing so hard. He was laughing during the chase sequence. People are loving this movie.
Who is watching this movie? No one's watching this movie. It's set to take the throne from The Flash for being the biggest box office bomb in box office history. Who is watching this movie? Who is putting money into this to make this?
$100 million. There are no kids. There were no young adults besides Emily and I in our movie theater, and it was packed, but it was all the older people that I sat with when they were watching Top Gun Maverick. Like, it was all those same people, those older people. I don't know, man. I don't get the 89%. I really don't, because I saw that. And I'm just like,
that's astonishing.
I don't know. Maybe the whole older generation discovered Rotten Tomatoes and started logging their logging their ratings. Like, that just makes
sense. I liked it. 5 stars. I laughed. 5 stars.
And like I said, there was so much I wanted to do to just sit back and enjoy this movie, but literally they crossed some lines that just did not make sense. Not even in an Indiana Jones perspective, but just like a thematic, cinematic perspective, where it's like, that literally makes no sense. Like, why in the world would that make sense for you to make that decision in the story? But here's the other thing too. I think this is also what part of the ingredient that makes a good Indiana Jones movie is the artifact. When you have a good, solid artifact that people know of, hence the Ark of the Covenant, the Holy Grail, those kind of things, people attach to that. Like, people are just as invested as Indiana Jones when they know what the artifact is. When they don't, when it's a skull, when it's a golden egg, when it's this clock, the dial of destiny, what no one's ever heard of, in my opinion, I think you lose me. Like, I mean, you could have gone so fictitious with, I don't know, like Indiana Jones and the 11th commandment. I don't know. Just make something up so that we vaguely know. The 11th commandment. The nails of the cross. I don't know. Like, just something that we would be vaguely familiar with instead of choosing this really dumb, fictitious clock that we've never heard of or don't even care about.
Well, yeah, familiar with and something that like piques our interest, you know, because when you right. say like Indiana Jones is looking for the Ark of the Covenant, you're like, whoa, that's like,
whoa,
I wonder what's in there, because we hear about it and we've always mm-hmm. ourselves would like to know what's inside the Ark of the Covenant. But then you right. hear about Archimedes and like the Dial of Destiny and you're like, what?
Like, the cool thing about it is it's one of the world's oldest computers. It tells the it tells 4 year spans for likely the Olympics. That was that's the thing he's after, not this time travel.
Man, I don't care.
Yeah, no. Even the premise of the artifact itself is lame. Like, yeah. They really had to dig deep to try to make this thing interesting. There's other artifacts, like you guys said, that could easily be fantasize within some level, some basis of reality to make it an interesting MacGuffin. This is literally like, you might as well call it something else. Like,
yeah, honestly, they could have just, you're right. You pointed it out like 10 minutes ago, but like, why couldn't they just stick with the dagger, the knife? Like, why couldn't, yeah.
That's way more interesting. When, like, that has more implications.
Immediately when they mentioned it, I was like, oh, I thought this movie was like, I guess that's the Dial of Destiny. And then like 5 minutes later, they're like, it's a fake. I'm after this time traveling device. And I'm like, oh my God.
It just felt like to me that like that was the original plot point. But then like, I don't know, someone else came on, thought that was really stupid. And that was like a jab at that entire like first draft. Like, oh, the spear is fake. Oh, it's so lame. Yeah, because they mentioned like Hitler wanted to do something with it or whatever. And then Mads is like, no. I have something far more powerful that the Fuhrer, like, it will make the Fuhrer great. And they're like, you only have a half of it. What's the big deal? They made a bigger deal yeah. about the fake movie prop than they did about the actual MacGuffin.
Why would the artifact be in two parts? That's the other stupid thing. Like, no artifact is like in two parts. Like,
so we can have a movie.
so we can have Indiana Jones
again.
That's over villains to every single step of the investigation,
and that's my problem. They're overthinking it. Why do we have to yeah. find the other part of an artifact? Why can't we just find an artifact?
This
why
sounds can't like we just Rise of Skywalker?
You're not wrong, because the image I have in my head is when Rey is standing on the hill and she holds the knife up to the Death Star, and for some reason she's like, oh, it lines up perfectly. It must be there. I'll never forget how I felt like in the movie theater premiere night in Rise of Skywalker, and I don't talk about that movie a lot, but I remember seeing that scene. I just felt like the pit of my stomach drop. I was like, they really did that.
It was way before that for me.
And the fact that they're supposed to be sending off Indiana Jones, you would think yep. they'd bring back some characters from previous movies, and yet they're introducing all these new characters and expecting us to care about them.
Because they like, don't care about Indiana Jones.
Why is Sala here? He's just there. Give him hell, Dr. Jones. Okay, Gimli. Like, okay, go back home.
Like, it's plain and simple. They never cared about Indiana Jones, and that's so sad for Harrison Ford, but they never cared about Indiana Jones. They cared about the potential profit that Indiana Jones could have brought them and saved Disney. That's the true meaning behind this movie, which is super sad because Harrison Ford definitely deserved better. But I will say this, I think Steven Spielberg is the master at creating sagas that are really just based on one really good movie.
Oh yeah,
did it with Jurassic Park, Indiana Jones. But yeah, that's and as we go forward here, one of us did see it in IMAX, and Brandon, give us your 30-second IMAX review. Is it worth it? Is it worth the $25 price ticket to see this movie in IMAX?
Heck no. Where's that little, your little sound effect?
And let's also explain that he did not do so by choice. His original theater of choice was closed down due to a shooting incident, which was as bad, as dark humor as it is, that was probably a warning sign.
Our thoughts and prayers to the victims of Albuquerque and Century Rio 24.
100%. But yeah, he did not choose to spend the $25. That was just the next best experience.
I went to my showing and then the parking lot was completely empty. I was like, what the heck? This is so weird. And then I noticed that my ticket had been refunded. And I was like, dang it. Well, I got to find another showing real quick. And they had a 7 o'clock showing at IMAX. So I'm like, might as well. I think this would be pretty cool to see in IMAX. Yeah, it's not worth it. It's not worth the extra money to pay to see this in IMAX. There's nothing of value.
It's not worth the money to see in theaters.
And that's probably why I don't like the de-aging, is because I saw like his full face was like even right worse. In front of me, you know?
It's even
so
worse.
I saw every single detail, and for me, it looked gross.
Wait for it for Disney Plus. That's our official recommendation. If you want to get to watch
this, yeah, do not pay to watch this.
Just don't watch it. Watch Kingdom of the Crystal Skull.
Yeah,
Kingdom of the Crystal Skull is fun.
It's better than this one. It's just, could you believe it? Better movie.
Could you believe it that this movie made Kingdom of the Crystal Skull better? Which I like. Like I said, I thought it was fun. I thought Skull was fun in the first place, but. As we close in on this movie review, our first stinker of the summer, unfortunately.
My second.
But if you guys want to close with some final thoughts as we wrap up here, again, this was disappointing. I didn't think it was going to be too hard to mess this movie up, and they did, and they did a lot of things wrong. I officially probably would give it a 2 out of 5. I'm not an Indiana Jones fanboy. I do appreciate the movies, though, but they really messed up big time on this one and tried to cash in on a really good property, in my opinion. And so 2 out of 5, and this movie is a stinker.
How many times?
That sounds like more than one, at least.
It's going to trigger our listeners to be like, oh, yeah, I got to go.
Yeah, what I have to say about this movie is so disappointing. It's so sad. I don't like anything about this movie. And it bums me out because I really do like the Indiana Jones films. There's something so classic about it. And nothing feels classic about this movie. So
nope.
Go watch another Disney movie like Little Mermaid or something.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, the new one, definitely, 100%.
Do you want to give it a rating? I know you mentioned at the beginning you're still wrestling with your out of five rating.
1 out of 5, yeah.
Whoa.
Yeah, I don't like this. I'm never going to see it again.
Wow.
I thought you liked it. Man, you said like what a proper send-off for Indiana Jones.
No.
I guess I thought you were going to come at it with an optimistic point of view, but that's surprising. No. I knew you didn't
like
it,
anything
but...
about it.
Oh, my God.
Well, just the guy that played the evil Nazi, that was the only thing. Like.
Edward...
Yeah, this movie sucked. I was more entertained by my fan theory for the final scene than I was of anything in this entire movie.
Oh my gosh.
Does it hurt here? Does it hurt here? Indy was wild at the end of that movie.
He is a mutt.
And that head is more entertaining than anything in this movie.
You know that was a callback, right?
Yeah, I know. Like I said, it's just more funny to me. It was more entertaining to me because like he said that and I looked at Haley, I was like, he made spicy.
You better dial your destiny.
I had a dialed in Rita watching this movie at Flix Brewhouse. Did not make it any better. I had two more beers on top of that. Did not make it any better. This movie was was bad. I had a 2.5. I'm gonna drop that down to a 1.75. This movie is
honestly
sucks.
Yeah.
I think I'm
gonna leave mine at 2 out of 5. I don't know why, but it is easily one of the worst movies.
Your rating system so weird.
I don't care. I don't want to care more.
Movies weird this summer.
Across the Spider-Verse is still up there, even though
you're gonna
they
leave an extra point on the table, but you're not gonna give that extra point to Across the Spider-Verse.
It's not like minutes. It's not like rollover minutes. Like if I take half a point, I give it to another movie.
I just don't understand why I have to fight for you to like give Across the Spider-Verse like another
point.
Well,
now I have
5.
Ethical problems with Across the Spider-Verse because apparently they treat their VFX artists very poorly.
That is fair. So. That is fair.
But it's still
down
a 4
from a 6 to a 5.
A 6 to 5. Anyways, that's our thoughts on Indiana Jones and the Dial of Destiny, and hopefully the final installment of. They should have ended after the Crusade, after the last Crusade.
They confirmed 80s, this is it. They're done. He's done.
They said that after Kingdom of the Crystal Skull. I don't trust no one. They'll do anything for money. But hands down, Indiana Jones is still the best ride at Disneyland.
Oh yeah.
That ride is king. So? Oh yeah, that ride is so good.
When it's working,
it's like falling apart.
Yeah, when it's working, it's goaded. Every other time, it's not rating.
Didn't
you
get like whiplash on that ride? Did you like snap your neck?
Man, I get more whiplash on like the teacups than I do on Indiana Jones.
Yeah, that I think that's my favorite ride at yeah, I think it would be. And then Space Mountain right behind it. But that's it for our review on Indiana Jones Dial of Destiny, but be sure to stick around because we got some more. I feel like we're at the peak of summer. I know
we got 3 bangers coming up.
I know. Yeah, I know we just went through a stinker, but we got some good ones. And there's some good noise around Mission Impossible Dead Reckoning as it's currently sitting at a 98% with over 65 reviews from critics. So definitely
see it in IMAX.
Get your popcorn ready because we're definitely
Oppenheimer
gonna
coming up right after Oppenheimer and Barbie.
And Barbie. I'm excited
feature.
For Barbie too.
I'm doing that double
more
feature.
So Barbie than Oppenheimer.
Stop.
Same.
Stop.
I'm definitely going to see Barbie.
I know what kind of movie
Oppenheimer's
going to be, but I don't know what Barbie's going to be, and that makes me more excited. But both are going to be fantastic movies, 100%. I have no doubt.
But I'm going to go on the record right now that Mission Impossible will be better than Oppenheimer. I know it.
I'm
saying it now.
That's like apples and oranges, though.
Yeah, completely different movies.
Yeah, it's like an action movie. With a biopic about
what I mean is like when we're looking back at like the summer, like we're gonna say Mission Impossible was the better movie.
I'm gonna say Barbie. Man.
I think people are overhyping Oppenheimer. I think they really are.
They are.
I know it's gonna be a biopic. It's gonna be slow. It's 3 hours, but that's not the reason why I'm seeing the movie. And I'm pretty sure I will love it. I got back to back tickets. Tickets ready for opening night for Oppenheimer, and then I'm seeing it again the next day in IMAX again. Back
oh my
to back.
God.
Whoa.
I'm ready.
Nolan
6 hours.
Boy.
Oh, yeah. You already know. You seen my wall. I got all the posters.
He's already going to give this a 5 out of 5. He already rated
I'm a
the movie.
I'm a Nolan sexual.
He's going to do that Spider-Verse where he's like, it transcends traditional scoring. This is not a movie. This is not even a film. It is cinema.
I
have to watch it.
There's no secret around the fact that Nolan is my guy. And I can't remember the last time where I didn't know like a movie was going to come out of his. And I was like following everything. I'm not like Edward where I'm like reading the Oppenheimer script, but like, I'll like stick to the notes of like, oh, like, you know, this guy's going to be in it. She's going to be in it. And that gets me excited. But yeah. Anyways,
I just don't know how you're going to get excited after a movie like Tenet, which was a flop.
That wasn't its fault though. That wasn't the movie.
I'm all playing the sound effect. The sound effect is I know it's not my own sound effect. But I'm really excited. I think we got some really awesome movie reviews coming up. I really can't wait to talk about all three of these movies. It's gonna be so fun. But thank you so much for listening. We had so much fun talking about this movie, even though the movie itself was not fun itself. But it's always good to get it out of my system. I feel like I can go to sleep tonight. I'm well rested. Yeah. We'll see you guys next time. Be sure to hit that like button and subscribe for more movie content. And we'll see you guys for Mission Impossible. Bum, 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 bum.
You're nothing to me but customers.
You want to freeze to death?